Mrs. Nupur Tandon. She's a social entrepreneur. She worked as a manager in media, India, and then became trade officer in UB, France. She is the founding director of Pro Waste Concepts Private Limited, which aims She is the founding director of Pro Waste Concepts Private Limited, which aims to address the critical issues of waste management and proposes a holistic approach towards a decentralized, smart, integrated solid waste management system, which is eco-friendly, financially viable, and sustainable. We welcome you, ma'am.
Great insights this morning about solid waste management. So I'll also share my thoughts and some focus on details what Pro Waste Wing has been able to do since last 4 years. So our very clear vision about solid waste management has been a future without landfills. It's a very, very optimistic a dream which we are trying to work on. But this is the reality, the situation, which is a stark opposite of, you know, what we would like to have. The landfills, the dumps of waste, most of our waste ends up in these landfills, you know. So I don't know who's the reason, what are the reasons of these landfills. There are various factors which are the reason why all this waste which has generated comes up here. So some of the factors or some of the reasons I'll discuss here. This waste is increasing per day. I can compare it like a growing elephant. So I have, you know, and there are various parameters which are adding to this waste which is going in the landfill. So one of the parameters is the policy makers, which is maybe the ministry. What they are doing is they're not aware of the ground realities of waste. They have amended laws of the 2016 laws, but they are not at all involved in the real implementation of the waste situation at the ground level. They're not clear about what's happening at the ground level. So when we have the urban local bodies, they are the reasons, the responsibility of the implementation and execution of the waste management systems, but it has really been beyond their capacity. You know, the real challenge is the machinery which has actually failed. It's a robust infrastructure, but they have not been able to achieve. So what they are actually doing is just trying to collect the waste and go and dump it in the landfills. We might say that urban local bodies, they don't have enough funds or enough trained people or education. But some of the urban local bodies which I have worked with, you know, they have a large, huge amount of funds, and they have been boasting about the fleet of vehicles they have, which they are using just for collection of waste from one point, and they transfer it to the bigger vehicles and go and transfer it to the landfills. So they have actually failed to, you know, do any processing of the any category of waste. We also would like to include the contractors who actually work at the ground level, and also the workers who actually deal with the waste. They work in most inhuman conditions. They don't have infrastructure, they are educated. So there is actually no link between the people who are working at the ground level and the urban local bodies who are not interested actually to get this solution to be done. And you know, so that is the reason. And most of the money which is spent to transfer the waste, it's actually a very viable business. There's a lot of money which is involved in transportation of waste, so most of them are engaged in that sort of an activity. Then the generators of waste, this is us. So the generators of waste are actually, you know, we are not ready to sacrifice or give up our conveniences and our consuming habits. So to work together with these people to reduce the waste or help them to manage the waste. You know, and there's another important thing that we are not aware. The generators of waste are, they don't know what categories of waste are. How many of them in this room segregate their waste into three categories? Not two, three categories? I can hardly see anybody, just two or three people. Those who segregate their waste, do you know where it goes? Nobody knows where the waste goes. Yeah, so that is what I'm saying, because there is no sync between the various the pillars of the people who are involved in the waste management system. The policy makers at the ears of the elephant, and the legs are the urban local bodies. They're actually, they have to manage the show. And then the generators of waste. And all of them are fighting among each other and they're blaming each other. Yeah? And then there is technology providers, you know. So there is no dearth of technology. So in India, the recycling industry has been age-old recycling industry. The biogas plant, we all know about the biogas plant. You know, but we are trying to evolve new technology. Sometimes we want to, you know, just copy the technology from the West. We have to understand that doesn't work in India. Because the characteristic of the waste, the type of the waste generated in India is very, very different from the waste generated in the Western countries. Yeah, and most of the waste, the calorific value of the waste goes down because the high value waste is anyway taken out from the municipal solid waste by the rag pickers. Yeah, and India has a very high quantum of percentage of organic waste. So a lot of technology providers, we have to understand. We have to first learn about the characteristics of waste which is generated in India. You cannot just blindly follow the West. Why are we just ignoring the methods of composting, the primitive methods of composting, which is I think the best way of handling organic waste or a basic recycling of plastic and paper which already exist. Why are we not thinking of all those things? So it is always we are fighting among each other, blaming each other for the mess which we all have created. And definitely then comes the Swachh Bharat Mission. So what has changed after the Swachh Bharat Mission? Any ideas? Any inputs? What do you think? Awareness? So personal front, I would say that people like us are now being invited to talk on this kind of platforms. We were never really taken seriously. The way people in working in waste management were never taken seriously. And I would also say that my family was totally zapped when I left my job in the embassy of France, and they were like, they were quite upset that what am I going to do? So that's the recognition I received after Swachh Bharat Mission came, and then now they are quite, yeah, she's trying to clean up the country. So that's one thing on the personal front. But yes, we are talking about solid waste management since Swachh Bharat has come. It is indeed, as Prime Minister had said recently, it is one of the most successful movement in India. Yes, maybe. A lot of people are talking about it. So they say, Ek Kadam Swachhata Ki Or, but that one kadam is really not enough. Because what Swachh Bharat, yes, it has initiated some effort, some talk about it, but we have to make sure that waste should not be just swept out of the site. So they have to bring in proper systemic approach, a process. They have to talk about the process about handling all categories of waste. You know, I don't talk about open defecation at all. I just talk about solid waste management. The whole idea behind Swachhata Hi Seva and, you know, clean up campaigns and clean school and clean classrooms, the clean campus awards. I mean, I've seen them from a very near, but most of the campuses were the dirtiest ones have got these clean campus awards. I don't know how they afford to get all these things. So the parameters of Swachh Bharat mission and the process they have to, I think, they have to define, and their main criteria should be awareness. They have given bins to lot of villages because they have lot of funding which has come in, but that's not enough. Giving bins is not the solution. Just spending money on this project is not the solution. There has to be a proper process. So having said about it, whatever efforts we are taking, we have to be in synchronization. Otherwise, this elephant is going to be bigger and bigger and bigger. So yes, it's time to change. We have to rethink. We have to redesign and restructure. Otherwise, it is going to be the same situation. Nothing is going to happen. So let's talk about decentralized solid waste management. Until now, I mean, what we do is just everybody just packs the waste in the bag and puts it outside. It's collected by some contractor and is sent to it. There's a huge tons of waste every day which has been taken care of. Let's talk about decentralized solid waste management. There are reasons why ProWaste Concepts is able to do it, able to implement it at the ground level. So definitely it helps in recovery of resources. No money spent on the transport. Most of the institutes where I have worked, before we came in, they were spending thousands of rupees or even more than lakh of rupees per month just to send waste outside their premises. These campuses are huge, they have very high population, and they spend around 1.5 lakhs even to collect waste from the premises and send it out. So if you set up waste management processes, you save all that money. Employment and revenue generation, yes, waste generates revenue. If you manage your waste, you generate, you convert your waste into resources, and thus you generate revenue, and we divert waste from the landfills. So I would like to discuss a model, a stepwise model, which what ProWaste has, the way we have implemented in some of the campuses in Bangalore and some other universities and institutions in India. So it's a very, very systemic approach. It's a stepwise methodology, how we've been able to do it. So step one, it is very important to review the existing waste disposal system. You know, you just cannot start doing solid waste management and think that it will happen in overnight or just at the blink of your eyes. So there is a lot of planning and preparation which goes into it. So first step is very important to define the project area. So we take each project site like a small city. We consider it like a small city because there are various facilities on that campus, and each campus would generate various categories of waste. We have to identify it very, very efficiently, and we have to understand that, you know, the deficiency areas and gaps which are available. Unless we do all that groundwork, we'll not be able to build, we'll not be able to plan for the solid waste management project. It's very important for the mapping and quantification of each category of waste generated on each facility. We have to understand here that just keeping dual bins or color-coded bins or, you know, bins in some corner of any facility or a room or it doesn't work. You know, you must have seen this three bins in the airport, and if you go and see inside it, there are all categories of waste in all the sections. You can go and see any bin anywhere. So we have to understand that a mess or a canteen in a campus site would generate only organic waste. They would not generate biomedical waste. Or a hostel room in any campus would generate, a room would generate paper and plastic, and toilets would generate only biomedical waste. So all that kind of mapping and quantification of waste is very, very important to prepare the basis on what you build the whole project. So after a very, very thorough review and the preparation of report, or then we go on the second step, that is preparation and plan and infrastructure. That is what is missing today. There's a huge gap. We all want clean, a clean campus or a clean society, but we just don't build on correct infrastructure. We just put bins, that's it. And somebody comes and collects all the waste, takes it to the landfill. So we have to understand that we have to define the norms and operations from point A at the source of generation of waste till point Z, where each category of waste will be disposed of safely. Until unless all processes in this from point A to point Z is synchronized, it is well defined, it is not going to work. So it is very important to understand, define and make sure that all the parameters of this are well planned and prepared. So of course we have to understand that we need some people who are important to run the show. So all that has to be done, a waste management supervisor or a green office or a sustainable team or a team of volunteers, a team of some passionate people. All that has to be in place because it is a teamwork, and it is including everybody's participation on the campus or any other government organization where we do the project. So infrastructure set up to enforce segregation of waste at source in all facilities. So I just said that it's very important to have correct bins at correct spaces. You know, so in the kitchen you cannot have just a small bin, or you have to have bins which will collect organic waste and paper plastic waste separately. You cannot put in your masala packets or bread packets or milk packets into the organic waste. We have to work on all this very, very minutely. You know, at workstations we have to understand which bin to keep, and then set up a system, a process where the collection team would know that what bins they have to take where. I mean, they cannot go and put the bins with paper and plastic in a composting pit or organic waste. So all that process has to be aligned. Service delivery norms, we have to understand that all those contracts and with vendors and all have to be in place before we start off. It takes a long, long time to set up all these systems. And technology providers for day safe disposal for all categories of waste. Then maybe you need a biomass plant, or you need somebody to make a pitch for you, or you need a vendor in space in the place to dispose of your biomedical waste or sanitary waste and diaper waste. In a lot of colleges there are some chemical waste from the labs or biomedical hazardous waste from the labs. So we don't want all that going into the waste stream in the dump yards. You'll have to have put vendors in place who will collect your paper plastic for recycling. So all that has to be in place before you start off. Otherwise, everything will fall apart, everything will be mixed again, and it will go to the landfills. It won't serve the purpose. So this is something again, step three, which is again the most important. We fail to identify what waste goes where. We educated people are not unable to do it, and it is very important to train the sanitation workers and enable them to handle all categories of waste. I mean, I have had situations where I was doing an audit round, and this lady had put diapers in the dry waste bag, and I asked her that, I'm sorry, but you have to, why do you put diapers? It is a biomedical waste. And I was shocked by the answer she gave me. She says, as my child had constipation today, so the diaper is dry. I did not know what to say. So this is the level of education, I'll not say education, but awareness about identifying the categories of waste we all have. We don't know what is what. Or some people would put empty milk packets in a wet waste bin, and they would say that because it is wet, but they have no, it is not an organic waste, it is a paper plastic waste. So that amount of training and awareness and education, the correct identification of each category of waste goes into the project. You know, we work very, very closely with the community. We work with the students, we work with the faculty, we work with the staff, we work with the residents, and we work a lot with the people who are actually helping us to handle the waste. They have to identify the waste very well. Only then they can handle it, and it's very important to give them protective gears to manage the waste efficiently. And you just can't expect them to pick up sanitary waste or diaper waste with their hands. So there has to be a proper system or process and an infrastructure to help them to, carry out those processes. So we work mass awareness campaigns for waste generators. We work with the kids, I just mentioned all that. So we have to work with it's a people project. We include everybody in the community to help us to manage this waste. So then, after all the preparation is done, awareness is given. So we commission the whole process. We make sure that all categories of waste from all the facilities is picked up, is properly handled, is collected, is transported, stored, and disposed at a proper method which is being planned. So probably we work on large campuses, so they have a composting site or a biogas plant. So all the organic waste which goes into the composting site, and we get very good manure and out of it, and all paper plastic goes for recycling, and institutions are earning revenue out of selling their paper and plastic. So that is a model we are working on, and we implement standard operating procedures, and we give guidelines to all the stakeholders on the campus so that it is followed, and we ensure that the project runs on the auto mode. We do frequent waste audits, corrective and preventive measures to address the issues if any, and of course we have to keep on reinforcing these systems to make sure that all the processes are followed correctly. So this is what we achieve in the end. All organic waste, biomass can be taken care of, paper plastic is taken care of, e-waste, medical waste. I have not put all the categories, but there are many others. So that is what we are aiming at, and not waste going to the landfills. I would like to add on that waste management is not just per se waste management. We have to fight a lot of deep-rooted corruption which is in the sector. We have to fight to give dignity to the waste handlers in our society. Without that, we cannot achieve this. Because once, they are really the people who are helping us in this country. And also, our biggest challenge is our own mindsets. There are people, even if they understand waste management and why they should do it, they are still not ready to segregate their waste and support the cause. So that's the end of my presentation. So that is what we are aiming for. In the end, I would definitely like to point out that whatever systems we have, decentralized, centralized, segregation of waste or whatever, but reduction of waste is prime. So it is a request to all that whenever we go out, let's carry our water bottles, let's go with the cotton bags, let's reduce use of single-use plastic and save the world. Thank you so much.
We can take two questions.
Hello, Nubal.
Not exactly a question. You was talking about policy makers. You was talking about urban local bodies, which are not of much help. You was talking about technology providers, SBM, generators of waste. But I think these all points are starts from the second step. The first step is we, because we are responsible for all this waste management. And as in the panel section, Mr. Tripathi, if I am taking his name correctly, he said about that what we don't do here, we do it in Dubai. Before, not in fact even in Dubai or a foreign country, we do it even in our country. We till Noida, we go without seatbelt, without helmet. And the moment we have to cross Delhi, we just put on the seatbelt and the helmet. Same thing is with the waste. Because we have to stop that thing that I am going with my car, unwrapping my cigarette pack and then throwing it on the road. So the first thing, it should be we. Then only all these things start. This is the problem.
Presentation that the reduction of waste is all about us, and the biggest challenge was our mindset. It is us. Policy makers are part of us. The urban local bodies are part of us. We have to think of our actions.
All those present in this hall, I would say the waste has never been an issue as far as we Indians are concerned. Because till about mid-80s, whatever waste was there was all natural waste. And nature takes care of the waste by itself. There is no waste in nature. If you study it thoroughly, there is no waste in nature. Everything you buy, reuse, recycle. Waste started soon after we had plastic brought into this. And then one after another, a new variety of the waste got introduced. And today, all those present here, I can tell you, how many of us are really concerned about our surroundings? We all clean our houses. I in Kanpur say there are people who spend thousands of rupees every month in cleaning their house, but they throw the waste on their streets. I can tell you in almost all the houses. So we all have to be aware about the waste what is generated. Here we take this bottle, for example. What do we do with it? We use water, drink water, quarter bottle, half bottle, then what do we do? So I say in all the season, this hall, go outside and see what is the waste. We all have to be concerned. We are not concerned beyond cleaning our own surroundings. So we have to concern beyond that, as it is said, how many of us really know where the waste goes from our house? Today we start thinking that in Kanpur, the claim is 1200 tons per day. 1200 tons multiplied by 335 is divided into the cubic meter of the space it will occupy. And if 6.2 million is reported to be in this country, again convert into the cubic meter of the space it is required. I have seen in USA 100 meters high landfills, but those landfills are a big trouble today. Our Kanpur is really not having land because all the new projects coming, there is no land provided. 8 projects in UP have never got started because the land was not available. So dear friends, land is very, very precious. It will not have land to live. I am from the West for one reason. I live in the West. I think of the West. And believe me, I am spending most of time on West. Any technology, whatever is recommended, is not functional in our country. This is not that I am challenging. I would like any one of you to mention any running plant in India. I would like to go and see. I keep going to all the places where somebody recommends. Our speaker has not come. He has a planned state policy for solid waste management UP. If we go through that policy, had he been here, I could have asked. I asked him, tell me the place. He says, Ambikapur. I was in Ambikapur within 10 minutes. You will be surprised to know how 10 minutes. My eyes are there. Mr. Dhanlal is there, Dhanpichor is there. I ran him up and found out what is the truth. So, we all have to be aware. We have gathered here for solid waste today. Let solid waste be the issue and let us all be concerned about it. And then I can tell you, we will have a change.
to just to collect waste from the province and send it out. So if you set up waste management processes, you save all that money. Employment and revenue generation, yes, waste generates revenue. If you manage your waste, you generate, you convert your waste into resources, and thus you generate revenue, and we divert waste from the landfills. So I would like to discuss a model, a stepwise model, which what ProWaste has, the way we have implemented in some of the campuses in Bangalore and some other universities and institutions in India. So it's a very, very systemic approach. It's a stepwise methodology, how we've been able to do it. So step one, it is very important to review the existing waste disposal system. You know, you just cannot start doing solid waste management and think that it will happen in overnight or just at a blink of your eyes. So there is a lot of planning and preparation which goes into it. So first step is very important to define the project area. So we take each project site like a small city. We consider it like a small city because there are various facilities on that campus, and each campus would generate various categories of waste. We have to identify it very, very efficiently, and we have to understand that, you know, the deficiency areas and gaps which are available. Unless we do all that groundwork, we'll not be able to build, we'll not be able to plan for the solid waste management project. It's very important to for a mapping and quantification of each category of waste generated on each facility. We have to understand here that just keeping dual bins or color-coded bins or, you know, bins in some corner of any facility or a room it doesn't work. You know, you must have seen this three bins in the airport, and if you go and see inside it, there are all categories of waste in all the sections. You can go and see any bin anywhere. So we have to understand that a mess or a canteen in a campus site would generate only organic waste. They would not generate biomedical waste. Or a hostel room in any campus would generate, a room would generate paper and plastic, and toilets would generate only biomedical waste. So all that kind of mapping and quantification of waste is very, very important to prepare the basis on what you build the whole project. So after a very, very thorough review and the preparation of report, or then we go on the second step, that is preparation and planning and infrastructure. That is what is missing today. There's a huge gap. We all want clean, a clean campus or a clean society, but we just don't build on correct infrastructure. We just put bins, that's it. And somebody comes and collects all the waste, takes it to the landfill. So we have to understand that we have to define the norms and operations from point A at the source of generation of waste till point Z, where each category of waste will be disposed of safely. Until unless we the whole all processes in this from point A to point Z is synchronized, it is well defined, it is not going to work. So it is very important to understand, define and make sure that all the parameters of this are well planned and prepared. So of course we have to understand that we need some people who are important to run the show. So all that has to be done, a waste management supervisor or a green office or a sustainable team or a team of volunteers, a team of some passionate people. All that has to be in place because it is a teamwork, and it is including everybody's participation on the campus or any other government organization where we do the project. So infrastructure set up to enforce segregation of waste at source in all facilities. So I just said that it's very important to have correct bins at correct spaces. You know, so in the kitchen, you cannot have just small bin, nor you have to have bins which will collect organic waste and paper plastic waste separately. You cannot put in your masala packets or, you know, bread packets or milk packets into the organic waste. We have to work on all this very, very minutely. You know, at workstations we have to understand which bin to keep. And then set up a system, a process where the collection team would know that what bins they have to take where. I mean, they cannot go and put the bins with paper and plastic in a composting pit or organic waste. So all that process has to be aligned. Service delivery norms, we have to understand that all those contracts and with vendors and all have to be in place before we start off. It takes a long, long time now to set up all these systems. And technology providers for day safe disposal for all categories of waste. Then maybe you need a biomass plant, or you need somebody to make a pit for you, or you need a vendor in space in the place to dispose of your biomedical waste or sanitary waste and diaper waste. In a lot of colleges, there are some chemical waste from the labs or biomedical hazardous waste from the labs. So we don't want all that going into the waste stream in the dump yards. You'll have to have put vendors in place who will collect your paper plastic for recycling. So all that has to be in place before you start off. Otherwise, you know, everything will fall apart, everything will be mixed again, and it will go to the landfills. It won't serve a purpose. So this is something again, a step three, which is again the most important. We fail to identify what waste goes where. We educated people are not unable to do it, and it is very important to train the sanitation workers and enable them to handle all categories of waste. I mean, I have had situations where I was doing an audit round, and this lady had put diapers in the dry waste bag, and I asked her that, "I'm sorry, but you have to. Why did you put diapers? It is a biomedical waste." And I was shocked by the answer she gave me. She says, "As my child had constipation today, so the diaper is dry." I did not know what to say. So this is the level of education, not awareness about identifying the categories of waste we all have. We don't know what is what. Or some people would put empty milk packets in a wet waste bin, and they would say that because it is wet, but they have to. It is not an organic waste. It is a paper plastic waste. So that amount of training and awareness and education, the correct identification of each category of waste goes into the project. You know, we work very, very closely with the community. We work with the students, we work with the faculty, we work with the staff, we work with the residents, and we work a lot with the people who are actually helping us to handle the waste. They have to identify the waste very well. Only then they can handle it, and be very important to give them protective gears to manage the waste efficiently. And you just can't expect them to pick up sanitary waste or diaper waste with their hands. So there has to be a proper system or process and an infrastructure to help them to, you know, carry out those processes. So we work mass awareness campaigns for waste generators. We work with the kids, I just mentioned all that. So we have to work with, it's a people project. We include everybody in the community to help us to manage this waste. So then after all the preparation is done, awareness is given. So we commission the whole process. We make sure that all categories of waste from all the facilities is picked up, is properly handled, is collected, is transported, stored and disposed at a proper method which is being planned. So probably we work on large campuses, so they have a composting site or a biogas plant. So all the organic waste it goes into the composting site, and we get very good manure and out of it, and all paper plastic goes for recycling, and institutions are earning revenue out of selling their paper and plastic. So that is a model we are working on, and we implement standard operating procedures, and we give guidelines to all the stakeholders on the campus so that it is followed, and it's the, and we ensure that the project runs on the auto mode. We do frequent waste audits, corrective and preventive measures to address the issues if any. And of course, we have to keep on reinforcing these systems to make sure that all the processes are followed correctly. So this is what we achieve in the end. All organic waste, biomass can be taken care of, paper plastic is taken care of, e-waste, medical waste. I have not put all the categories, but there are many others. So that is what we are aiming at, and not waste going to the landfills. I would like to add on that that waste management is not just per se waste management. We have to fight a lot of deep-rooted corruption which is in the sector. We have to fight to give dignity to the waste handlers in our society. Without that, we cannot achieve this. Because once, they are really the people who are helping us in this country. And also, our biggest challenge is our own mindsets. There are people, even if they understand waste management and why they should do it, they are still not ready to segregate their waste and support the cause. So that's the end of my presentation. So that is what we are aiming for. In the end, I would definitely like to point out that whatever systems we have, decentralized, centralized, segregation of waste or whatever, but reduction of waste is prime. So it is a request to all that whenever we go out, let's carry our water bottles, let's go with the cotton bags, let's reduce use of single-use plastic and save the world. Thank you so much.
We can take 2 questions.
Hello. Not exactly a question. You was talking about policy makers. You was talking about urban local bodies, which are not of much help. You was talking about technology providers, SBM, generators of waste. But I think these all points are starts from step. The first step is we, because we are responsible for all this waste management. And as in the panel section, Mr. Tripathi, if I am taking his name correctly, he said about that what we don't do here, we do it in Dubai. Before, not in fact even in Dubai or a foreign country, we do it even in our country. We till Noida, we go without seatbelt, without helmet. And the moment we have to cross Delhi, we just put on the seatbelt and the helmet. Same thing is with the waste. Because we have to stop that thing that I am going with my car, unwrapping my cigarette pack and then throwing it on the road. So the first thing is, it should be we. Then only all these things start. This is the first.
That's what I said. Presentation that the reduction of waste is all about us, and the biggest challenge was our mindset. It is us. Policymakers are part of us. The urban local bodies are part of us. We have to think of our actions.
All those present in this hall, I would say, the waste has never been an issue as far as we Indians are concerned. Because till about mid-80s, whatever waste was there was all natural waste. And nature takes care of the waste by itself. There is no waste in nature. If you study it thoroughly, there is no waste in nature. Everything used by reuse, recycle. Waste started soon after we had plastic brought into this. And then one after another, a new variety of the waste got introduced. And today, all those present here, I can tell you, how many of us are really concerned about our surroundings? We all clean our houses. I in Kanpur say there are people who spend thousands of rupees every month in cleaning their house, but they throw the waste on their streets. I can tell you in almost all the houses. So we all have to be aware about the waste what is generated. Here we take this bottle for example. What do we do with it? We use water, drink water, water bottle, half bottle, then what do we do? So I say in all the season, this hall, go outside and see what is the waste. We all have to be concerned. We are not concerned beyond cleaning our own surroundings. So we have to concern beyond that, as it is said, how many of us really know where the waste goes from our house? Today we start thinking that in Kanpur, the claim is 1200 tons per day. 1200 tons multiplied by 335 is divided into the cubic meter of the space it will occupy. And if 6.2 million is reported to be in this country, again convert into the cubic meter of the space it is required. I have seen in USA 100 meters high landfills, but those landfills are a big trouble today. Our Kanpur is really not having land because the, all the new projects coming, there is no land provided. 8 projects in UP have never got started because the land was not available. So dear friends, land is very, very precious. It will not have land to live. I am from the West for one reason. I live in the West. I think of the West. And believe me, I am spending most of time on West. Any technology, whatever is recommended, is not functional in our country. This is not that I am challenging. I would like any one of you to mention any running plant in India. I would like to go and see. I keep going to all the places where somebody recommends. Our speaker has not come. He has a planned state policy for solid waste management, UP. It would go through that policy. Had he been here, I could have asked. I asked him that in the place. He said, Ambikapur. I was in Ambikapur within 10 minutes. You will be surprised to know how 10 minutes. My eyes are there. Mr. Nandlal is there. Nandkishore is there. I ran him up and found out what is the truth. So, we all have to be aware. We have gathered here for solid waste today. Let solid waste be the issue and let us all be concerned about it. And then I can tell you, we will have a change.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for the enlightening session. And I'm sure it was a very insightful session for the audience. Now I would like to call upon stage Suresh Chandra Tripathi to present the memento. Speaker for today is Mr. Kirti Bhushan Pradhan, Senior Advisor at Vision Spring, a global social enterprise and healthcare sector. Let's welcome him on the stage and hear his views on sustainable healthcare enterprises.
So this time I'll change my hat, not on Vision Spring, but I'll be talking about sustainable healthcare models which is suitable for our country. Again, I'll ask you, how many of you have seen Tirupati temple? Both come. So, dekha rahi hai, main unko bata deta hu. I'm just telling you. Tirupati temple mein bhi God ne divide kiya hai. Jo zyada paisa dega, wo jaldi dekhega. So, this is our country. This is the truth. Let us accept it. In our country, whatever you have seen in the presentations, from research, from internet, that's one part. Let me tell you my analysis. In a country like India, we have 6 layers of people. Poor, lower middle class, upper middle class, rich, super rich. You don't see this kind of layers in any country of the world. And this is the truth. All these internet demography you see, वो सब average जैसा है, average जैसा मतलब मैं समझा देता हूँ आपको। राम ने 10 बनाना खाया, श्याम ने 2 खाया, 10 plus 2 divided by 2 is 6, correct? लेकिन 6 बनाना कोई नहीं खाया। तो what you see in the internet, today somebody showed in the presentation. For every 900 people, there is one doctor, correct? This average is average, very misleading. Very, very misleading. Rural population, 5,000 people, one doctor. City, 300 people, एक डॉक्टर है, 200 लोगों में एक डॉक्टर, भरे हुए हैं डॉक्टर्स। सो एवरेज के ऊपर मत जाओ। सो ट्रूथ इज इन आवर कंट्री दिस लेयर्स आर देयर, दैट इज व्हाट तिरुपति भगवान भी और लाइन सिस्टम कर दिया है। आप फ्री में देखोगे वो लाइन भी है, बहुत देर लगेगा देखने के लिए भगवान को। बहुत पैसा दोगे तुरंत आपको कोई आके लेके जाएगा भगवान को दिखाने के लिए। By the way, जो देखा नहीं है तिरुपति थोड़ा बंद रहो, सबसे रिचेस्ट भगवान है, यूपी को 3 बार खरीदेगा 3 बार बेचेगा, इतना पैसा है। And that is the truth, that is the truth, bitter truth of our country. Taking that into consideration, I would like to tell something. Health certainly is not everything, but everything without health, nothing. एक रिच मैन है, उसके पास सब कुछ है, कैंसर हो गया, हार्ट अटैक हो गया, इज देयर एनी वैल्यू ऑफ दैट मनी? सो दैट इज द रीजन व्हाई टुडे वी आर डिस्कसिंग अ लॉट अबाउट हेल्थ, रिवॉल्व्स अराउंड हेल्थ अ लॉट, एंड हेल्थ रिलेट्स टू एवरी ह्यूमन बीइंग हियर, एवरीवेयर, इट पिंचेस यू डायरेक्टली। सो दैट इज द रीजन व्हाई वी आर टॉकिंग अ लॉट अबाउट हेल्थ। When it comes to the sustainable healthcare, how can we have sustainable healthcare in our poorer or needy states like Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Chhattisgarh, Odisha, Northeast? When it comes to healthcare, South India is very well developed. If you ask me as a healthcare management expert of 25 years of experience, what South India has achieved, if North India, I'm dividing India into two parts, South and North, no East, West, nothing. If I divide India into two parts, what South has achieved in healthcare, if North has to achieve, it will take another 15 years if we all start working in a very meticulous way, the way West management is getting planned. If we work that systematic, it will take 15 to 20 years for North India to come to the level of South India. That's it. It's a statement I'm making. Coming back to the sustainable, how South India has done. The one of the top models, Aurobindo Eye Hospital, Narayan Hrudayalaya, Shankar Netralaya. Aapka IIT ka, sorry, not IIT ka, Kanpur mein Shankara bolke hospital hai, Shankara Eye Hospital. Aapne kuch dekhe hoge, kuch nahi dekhe hoge, for outskirt mein kaha. Only South Indian group which has dared to venture, itna sahas banaya hai, aake North India mein apna hospital baithaya hai. Kaise chal raha hai, kya chal raha hai, I have not done much analysis on that, but chal raha hai. So what I'm trying to tell is, there are a lot of South Indian hospitals who have done wonderful models of sustainable healthcare, which we all have to learn and be social entrepreneurs to set up those kind of hospitals by learning the principles how they have done it. If I have to tell that story, it will take probably 2 days of full-time session. So what I'll cut short that and give you an example. And probably from that example, you will get the key principles. Because all of you will not be able to see Aurobindo unless I show you a picture or something. But all of you have seen Indian trains. आपने रेल देखा है? Indian rail. सब travel किया होगा. जरूर ऐसा कोई नहीं होगा कि शायद तिरुपति नहीं गए हैं. But at least everybody must have traveled by train. Indian का जो train है. कितने division है Indian train में? General bogie. Second class reserve, 3-tier AC, 2-tier AC, correct? First class AC, ये है ना? कितने दिन से हैं? ये Indian Railways is there for last so many years. जो बनाया है बिना सोच के बनाया नहीं है, यही Indian population. गरीब भी जाएगा, middle class भी जाएगा, upper middle class भी जाएगा, rich भी जाएगा, super rich भी जाएगा train में. Understand the principle, exactly. That is the principle which is used in South Indian wonderful models to serve their population. And they're highly profitable. Indian Railways is highly profitable. Indian Railways is a profitable public sector nahi hai country mein. Jitne logo ko employment diya hai, koi bhi organization India mein nahi diya hai. So I'm just giving analogy. If you understand Indian Railways, you will be able to make a fantastic healthcare setup in any part of the country. As an entrepreneur, as a social entrepreneur. So, That is the way. So if you ask me a question, how they have done it? Indian railways mein jab koi bhikari, koi garib log, general class mein 100 rupaye ka ticket kaat ke yahan se Lucknow, yahan se Delhi jata hai. Railways doesn't make any money. It's a loss. There is a crush subsidy. The rich who travel in 3-tier AC, reserved bogies, 2-tier AC, whatever money they pay, 2,000 rupees, 3,000 rupees, it's crush subsidizes. And that is the principle. That is number one principle. Number two, economies of scale. आप जब high volume काम करोगे, जो margin आएगा, that makes the profit. तो थोड़ा-थोड़ा आएगा, ज़्यादा आएगा. But you do high volume work in your hospital. You cannot be serving only 20% of the population and trying to make money. It's to all care about population. The other underlying principle is, if you serve all the classes in the same service facility, like Indian Railways, आप सोचो कि अगर Indian Railways गरीब लोगों के लिए खाली गरीब डब्बा वाला ट्रेन बनाया होता, that train could not be maintained clean. जो क्लीनर क्या करेगा, ये गरीब लोगों का ट्रेन है, उसको इसे छोड़ दो यार, पानी मार के छोड़ दो. Because he is cleaning for the entire train, where second AC is there, first AC is there, 3-tier AC is there, all are standardized. The cleaning system is highly standardized. Even the general class body is getting clean. And that is the basic principle of a wonderful, sustainable social enterprise in healthcare. So, Arvind Eye Hospital, Narayan Hrudayalaya, jo bhi jitne bhi models hain, they have done exactly that. If I have to give you statistics quickly, Arvind Eye Hospital does 40 lakhs, they see 40 lakhs patients per year. 40 lakh patients dekhte hain per year. 4 lakh surgery karte hain aankh ka. 400 crore ka revenue hai. 100 crore ka profit hai. 50% free, 50% pay. In a very ballpark figure I'm talking about. As of today, this is the kind of 100 crores profit by serving the poor. 50% people get free treatment there. No organization in the world has shown that kind of model. And that is the reason that's a Harvard case study. That's discussed in all business schools of the world, including India. If you have any MBA in the country, you can study it as a case study. The unfortunate thing is, in India, we never try to see what is there. We don't see ki hamara country mein kya acha model hai. Usko kaise hum laake North India mein hospital kyun nahi hai? North Indian ka jo population kya paap kiya tha? Aisa service nahi paane ke liye. So we as entrepreneurs, as thinkers, as policy makers, we never think that ki acha kahan kya hai? Kahan acha banaya hai? Let us go and study that. Can we replicate that in our part to serve our population? Unfortunately, the healthcare providers, the doctors, the people who are setting up the hospitals, they're all in the mind of making profit. I want to serve only that 20% rich, super rich. Unme se paisa lunga, garib lunga, to government ka kaam hai. Which is not what South India has done. In their models, they have taken care of the entire society. And as a result, they are making money and they are the global models and self-sustainable. And there's a great learning. In my short talk, I really cannot tell every tips for what all goes into that. People come to study that even for a week. After staying there, studying that, very difficult to understand. And it's difficult in the sense, you have to put your brain into that. But I'm telling in a very nutshell the key points of that model. And for me, after working there for 13 years, I realized if I stay in South India, I'll feel very cozy. South India doesn't need my help. I need to be shifting to North India and be available for people, whoever wants to understand urban model, wants to try urban model in North India, a little bit of principles of urban model, I'm there to help them. And with this, hopefully I convey the concept to the Indian Railways and the Tirupati example. And these are the highly sustainable. Tirupati ka paas itna paisa hai, will never be unsustainable. So today what Tirupati is doing, setting up hospitals and all that surrounding Tirupati. So jo bhi aayenge, but the IMF technically they can give some free treatment and all that. But they're flooding with money. Because to see God also, that's something. There is free line, there is middle class line, there is high class line, all kind of lines are there. And the same model is somewhat in general ways, the same model what sustainable healthcare organizations have been practicing. Thank you. Any quick questions?
Questions, anyone?
Hope it's crystal clear.
Yeah. Thank you, sir, for this enlightening thing. And we compare the analogy of Indian Railways and the hospitality and the healthcare sector. That was very much informative for all of us. Moving on in this session, we now have Mr. Nixon Joseph, our next speaker. He's an experienced banker, a recipient of prestigious Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam Award for Professional Excellence. Mr. Joseph joined SBI in 1985 and currently is the President and Chief Operating Officer of SBI Foundation driving CSR activities of State Bank of India. He has also served in the capacity of CEO SBI Tokyo Branch. His key skills are investments, risk management, corporate finance, retail banking, credit analysis and syndication. Having completed 27 full marathons, the only public sector banker with such an achievement, which is a milestone and inspiration to many of us in the today's world. We welcome you, sir.
Good evening. I thank SCE for inviting me today and being part of a very continuous series of lessons on waste management, social entrepreneurship, etc. I am very much happy that I could be a part of it and learned a lot from this experience. The topic given to me is social initiatives and professional excellence. See that I will finish it within a few minutes without taking much time. Then CSR initiatives, social initiatives and professional excellence, I would like to relate it to my own experience. I was posted from Tokyo branch to Garo Hills, Meghalaya as a regional manager. It was almost like heaven and hell, because from a developed country like Japan, you are posted to a place like Garo Hills, Meghalaya, where development is, is very questionable. There is no hotel facility, there is no, electricity also comes and goes. Language is different. And the poverty level also was much, much, compared to other parts of India. But having been posted as regional manager, I was thinking what to do. CSR came handy for me. I did lot of CSR activities to engage with the people and also to engage with the employees. There were 400 employees of State Bank of India, and all of them were in a very, I should say, a confused state or a scared state, because kidnapping was very common. So to motivate all of them, and also to involve the community, the social initiatives become very handy. I organized an SBI Peace Run there, a Christmas Carol competition, MasterChef competition, similar activities for all the people in Garo Hills. These were 5 districts of Garo Hills were there under me, and I organized like that. I could find that within a few months, the entire community was thinking very highly about State Bank of India in Garo Hills. I could find that our own SBI colleagues were too much engaged with what is happening in the community also, the social activities. And they were also proud that the bank is doing such initiatives. What I want to tell is that because of these social initiatives, the image of SBI became very, very close to the hearts of the people there. How I could measure was that when two of my colleagues were kidnapped, the entire community was with me. The entire community joined the bank colleagues to appeal for release of these people, release of my colleagues. That is something I will tell you, see the impact of social initiatives on the society. That is from my personal experience I am sharing this. But when it goes to the corporate level, SBI was doing CSR activities since 1973, much before the CSR, the Companies Act was amended. And SBI used to always spend 1% of its profit for CSR activities. From philanthropy, we moved to sustainable projects, and therefore we started SBI Foundation in 2015. But even now, a lot of CSR activities are being done by SBI, like donation of ambulance, school bus, etc. Whereas sustainable projects, long-term projects are being done by SBI Foundation. And in SBI Foundation, we have three flagship projects. One is the SBI Youth for India Fellowship, other is the SBI Center of Excellence for Persons with Disabilities, and the SBI Gram Seva, which is the holistic development of villages. For the benefit of IITians, I would just mention about SBI Youth for India Fellowship. SBI Youth for India Fellowship is a platform for highly educated urban youth to connect with rural aspirations. It's a 13-month rural fellowship where we have partnered with 7 NGOs. After selecting the fellows, after orientation, we allot them to the NGOs. The NGOs also give them orientation, and then they spend 13 months in rural locations. The uniqueness of SBI Youth for India Fellowship is that we give total freedom to the youth to select the project they want. What we have done is that the first 3 months, the youth scout the village, interact with various stakeholders, and come to understand what are the pressing issues in the villages. And then they come out with innovative solutions to these issues, one of these issues. I'm very proud to tell that after completion of this fellowship, 60% of them continue in the development sector. And that is something SBI is very, very proud of, because otherwise, those who would have restrained themselves in cubicles are working in rural area social development sector now because of this fellowship. I should tell that 7,000 applications we receive every year for the 100 fellowships, out of which we shortlist 550 for the interview and select 100 fellows. And I'm very proud to state that even those who completed the study from Harvard University, Stanford, Oxford University, Cambridge, reputed universities in India, IIT and IIMs, many of them apply for our fellowship, and they are fellows and also alumni. They come out with very innovative projects, and some of them have become social entrepreneurs. In this connection, I will just mention something about the social entrepreneurship. One of the fellows I remember, his name is Anand Watts. He is an M.Tech in Mechanical Engineering from IIT Chennai. He was a fellow of 2015 batch, and he was allotted to Dams District, Gujarat, and he selected the project of working with bamboo craftsmen in Dams District. He was a mechanical engineer, so he came out with some simple equipment to reduce the drudgery of the bamboo craftsmen. After completing 13 months of fellowship, he went back to the village and became a social entrepreneur. He is now giving livelihood to 7 bamboo craftsmen, and they have started producing pens made out of bamboo. It is on the takeoff stage. Similarly, a lawyer from Delhi, a girl, she also worked with a bamboo craftsman in a dance district, and she has started a social enterprise of selling bamboo jewelry involving 7 women. So there are many stories about SBI Youth for India Fellowship, where highly educated people, youths have become social entrepreneurs. And the challenges as regard social entrepreneurship is similar to any other entrepreneurial activity, with the added pressure that you have to see that social impact is also there. I am a banker, therefore I have just analyzed what is like someone was asking what is the difference between social entrepreneur and business usual commercial activity. I would tell that for a commercial enterprise, the main focus is profit, and that is the final focus also, it's profit at any cost. For a social entrepreneur, through profit he is trying to make an impact on the society, he is trying to make a change. And this involves a lot of challenges in the sense that the social enterprise is starting on a small scale, and to upscale it, finance is required. Lot of leadership skill, marketing, patience, determination, passion, all these are required in volumes, because you have to compete with various other units as well. I'm telling this from my experience with the social entrepreneurs of SBI Youth for India Fellowship. So I have found that whatever difficulties the usual corporates or small SME units face, same things are faced in equal measure or more by the social entrepreneurs also. And it can be successful only if the person concerned is very, very passionate about his cause. Otherwise, he may leave it halfway. As regards CSR, I already told SBI has made it part of its ethos of doing CSR. Every year bank has been doing CSR activities. This year, because SBI ended March 18 on a loss, RBI has not permitted SBI to do CSR activities. Because as per RBI instruction, only 1% of profit could be used for CSR activities. But I am very proud that in spite of that, our SBI management took up with RBI to permit as a special case. But then it was not allowed, so we are continuing with the existing projects. But then I tell that why SBI is doing CSR is because it is a responsible corporate citizen. And it gives a very good image of the bank. So all the IITians who in future will be corporate leaders, I would tell that CSR is not only because the company sectors instructed or advised to do it, it also makes a very good sound business sense. And I will just share another view with you. Though it is called corporate social responsibility, it has to be changed to collective social responsibility. Because whatever has been discussed here today, yesterday also I had what is part of a panel discussion on air pollution in Delhi. Whatever is being suggested, whatever has to be done, all this has to be done by all of us. It's not in corporates, not governments alone. It has to be done by all of us. And as Mahatma Gandhi told, the change has to, we have to be the change. Whatever we are telling here, we have to be the change. And corporate social responsibility is not just 2% of the profit you spend on some activities and ticking off it has been done. No. Whatever the corporate is doing in its operations should also be like a responsible citizen. from Lehman Brothers to ICICI Bank, if you see, people were companies were not doing their role properly. Even independent actors who were supposed to do it were not doing their role properly. So this is not social responsibility. Social responsibility is not just doing whatever we want, in whatever way we want, just to make profit and then give 2% of it as CSR. This is something as IITians who are going to be the future leaders of corporates, I would tell them that from Lehman Brothers to ICICI Bank, all the financial fiascos which has happened, just see, these are all by highly educated people, people with degrees from very reputed Ivy League universities. A question comes here, what is the value these degrees are providing to our those who have been educated in these institutions? So apart from the degrees which we are getting, we have also to develop ourselves on ethics. As I told earlier, it's not corporate social responsibility, collective social responsibility, not only to the society in the social activities which have been mentioned, waste management or health or education, but also in the operations we are doing in daily life, in daily operations. If it is a bank, the way it is doing its things daily. If a corporate, the way whatever it is doing on a daily way, daily manner. In all these areas, social responsibility should be there. Otherwise, CSR is of no use. And that's all. And I only tell to all the young IITians, there is a lot of gap between rich and poor in India. There is a lot of scope for social entrepreneurship. You have a lot of ideas. You are young. You are with passion. And only those who have passion should take to social entrepreneurship, because it requires a lot of passion. And once you are in it, just don't give up. Because if your project, if your business plan is unique and acceptable, support will come from all the quarters. Thank you.
Hello. I just wanted to know a little bit more about the fellowship program that you have, and how the students or the alums can apply and be part of it.
See, during the month of February, March, we invite applications online through our site sbiyouthforindia.org. So online application is there. We also ask applicants to write an essay, that's also online. And based on that, we shortlist candidates for the interview. We also make telephone call to the candidates to see whether they are passionate about rural cause. We have 100 fellowships, but we don't fill 100 fellowships vacancies in spite of the fact that we are getting 7,000 applications every year. Because we are insisting that only those who are really passionate about rural development or social cause should join as SBI for India Fellowship. I have been interviewing, like this year I have personally interviewed all the 550 candidates, and then what I have found is that most of them don't know what to do. That is the one issue. And second thing is, many of them want to apply just to fill the 1 year gap. But we look for people who are passionate for this cause, rural cause, because we want at least many of them, at least some of them, to be social entrepreneurs or be in the development sector, because development sector also requires human resource, human capacity building. People with high education should be there in development sector. So we look into all these aspects for selecting the fellows, and we give them a monthly stipend of 15,000 rupees and 1,000 rupees transport allowance. And I should tell that most of the fellows have told that they are happy with this stipend. They need to spend only 4,000 or 5,000 rupees in the villages. And all of them have told that after this 13 months stint in the villages, their confidence has increased, their ability to face challenges has increased, because it is a shift from the urban luxury, urban comfort system to the rural scenario. But after 13 months, after spending in these rural locations, facing the challenges, they have become very bold, they have become future leaders. And as regards the fellowship, after selection, we give them an orientation program. The partnering NGO also gives the orientation program. In between, we have half-yearly reviews also of the performance of the fellows.
We can take one more question. All right.
Thank you so much, sir. So those were some very interesting experiences that you shared with us. And sir, as you correctly said during your note, it should be a collective change and a collective responsibility to make that we should move forward. Now I would like to invite Mr. Jatin Vaspani, present in the mentor to serve.